Okay. So the one special thing, like I said, is that what we want to do is we want to shift our weights down into the 7-segment display, and so that's this register is what accomplishes that. So everything else is very standard, very simple, except for, well, it takes in one byte and outputs 2 bytes. So what happens is it takes the input, every time you load the register, it takes whatever is on the input and concatenates it with the signal URRX data. And it only takes the least significant byte and shifts it down and puts the input into the least significant spot now. And then that signal just simply gets passed through to the output. Now I'll move on to the quad 7-segment driver. And this quad 7-segment driver, it is another module that I created, which has multiple processes in it, so we can see the application of that. And that module's here, and you can see it has clock and reset inputs, which are pretty general. I didn't include them in the diagram like most of the modules for simplicity. Then the input to display, which is here, output A to D segments, and the enable digit line. So I created several processes in this module as well. And to break down the processes, you could kind of try to break down what you want to accomplish. So as far as processes go, well, I'm not sure if you're aware of how 7-segment displays work, but I'll just give a quick explanation of how these work in case you don't. Basically, the general approach to driving these 7-segment displays is to, because this A to G controls the segments for all of these digits. So if you're to show a 1 on A to G, it's going to show 1 for every single digit, not just 1. Not just one of the digits. Same thing for E or 9, it gets displayed on all of them. So what happens, so what you're supposed to do is you're supposed to use this enable line, which is active low, so what you do is you can independently turn off any of these. So what you do is you turn on this one for a short amount of time, use this to display what value you want there really quickly, then quickly mux to the next one, then display whatever digit is supposed to be there, then here, so you alternate. So you display this digit, turn off the rest of them, display this digit, turn off the rest of them, display this digit, turn off the rest of them, display this digit, turn off the rest of them. And you do it so fast that the human eye can't see, or can't notice the blinking that's going on, actually, in reality. So you want, what you want to do is you want one process to handle what gets displayed on here, depending on what digit is currently being displayed. You want another process to control when these displays get turned on and off. And then I'm going to create another process that controls the rate at which we mux through these digits. So I'm going to start off by explaining the processes in here. What I do is I have this counter process that handles the rate at which I multiplex through the digits. And what I do is I just take this giant signal counter and I just sample out the most significant few bits to determine which digit do I display at what time. Because I take advantage of the fact that there's 4 digits to mux through, and that 4 can be represented uniquely with 2 bits. So on every rising clock edge, this gets incremented and this mux signal only gets assigned these 2 bits, like I said. And this signal is used throughout the rest of the module as a way to tell which digit to display. So when these two are 0, 0, that's going to display the first digit, 0, 1, second digit, 1, 0, third digit, 1, 1 is going to be the last digit. Now this process handles purely this output. So it uses the multiplexing bits that I have. If the multiplexing signal is 0, 0, these are active low, so that means what I'm doing is I'm just assigning SAN, which gets passed out to the output. If it's 0, 0, it's going to be 1, 1, 1, 0. And this line is active low, meaning that 0 is going to activate the first digit. And you can see in the comments. If it's 0, 1, display the second digit, turn off the rest. If it's 1, 0, display the third digit. If it's 1, 1, display the most significant digit and turn off the rest of them. So this process is really easy. And this process might look a bit cryptic, but it's actually also pretty easy. If you're currently displaying the first digit, what I want to do is I want to take the lower nibble of this input, so the least significant 4 bits from this input, the least significant 4 bits from that input, convert it to an integer, and then use that as a pointer in this lookup table, which goes from binary to segment. And then whatever the result of that is gets thrown out on the output to determine which segment's here to display. So how does this work? Here's the lookup table. So here's how 7 segments are broken down. It goes A, B, C, D, E, F, G. So seven different segments to light up. So what happens is that for 0, if I want to display 0, you can see I actually have 8. 8 bits here instead of 7 because the 8 is for the decimal point. So how it goes is decimal point A, B, C, D, E, F, G. And 0 is to turn the segment on, 1 is to turn the segment off. So for 0, if we want to display 0, I have 1, which means don't turn the decimal point on. 0 for A, 0 for B, 0 for C, 0 for D, 0 for E, and 0 for F, but keep D off. So if you look at the green, you can see it's 1 to 0. and I'll just do a few more examples so you kind of get the hang of it. Let's do five. So turn off the decimal point. A is on, B is off, C is on, D is on, E is off, F is on, G is on. So you can see that makes a five. And it continues like that, so 0 through F, three hacks. And so that's all this does, is it just takes the values from here and just uses a lookup table. So the lower nibble of this input is in decimal, 5. Then what's going to do is it's going to point to this, which is going to return D segments, so on this digit, display Z segments. That's all it does. So it's kind of funny how something so simple can actually do something pretty powerful, and that's all you need to do to get the quant 7 segment driver to work. So the top level is nothing special. If you've seen the last video, the lesson 2 video, you know kind of how tedious these can be. So it's just a matter of declaring all the components that I showed you in the top level up here. It's just a simple matter of declaring all the components that you see here. And the section after this begin, this section, because it's wiring it all up. The top level is always kind of the most boring and the easiest one to do. So this one's pretty self-explanatory. So when you build this project and import it, I mean, this should build right out of the box. There's really no reason. Just make sure that you have the right device selected up here, and that when you have this module, this one should be set as your top module. You can see these modules have the option to be set as a top module. This VGA top level should obviously be the top module. That should automatically be done for you, but just in case it doesn't, you need the baseboard UCF file to abstract the inputs and the outputs of the baseboard, so that way you can have nice, clean, easy to understand names like this. Of course, what you have to do is you have to right click on process properties and make sure you have allow unmatched LLC constraints checked. Otherwise, it's going to fail for you and it might be a weird why. Yep, this one will generate, and then all you have to do is use your Mercury programmer to get the VGA top level bit and just simply burn that straight to the Mercury board. Before we look at the product of our work, let's take a moment to let what we just accomplished soak into our minds. If you've seen all my FPGA videos, you might now be realizing which applications will outperform a microcontroller, and when you should use an FPGA in your projects. In my experience, there are two big situations where a hobbyist will want to use an FPGA in his or her design. The first situation is when you require parallel processing that can be executed very fluently. Take an oscilloscope example. We have our own drivers for the SPI protocol, a VGA protocol, and we create a driver for receiving UART. Three protocols being handled simultaneously with ease by the FPGA. Then we drive a set of 4-7 segment displays with a small bit of logic up here. The crazy thing is that we barely took up any space on the Spartan 3A with this application, and you could easily just create multiple instances of this top level and have multiple oscilloscopes running in parallel with no caveats. The only limitation that you have is when you run out lookup tables on the FPGA. Let's compare that to a microcontroller. The microcontroller very likely has its own dedicated hardware to SPI and UART, so no problems there. But then once you get to the VGA, I've personally never seen a microcontroller having hardware to drive a VGA protocol. So you'll have to bitbang this protocol. But if you bitbang, your software is pretty much locked up setting its timers so it knows when to set the pixels at the right time and when to activate the horizontal sync and vertical sync lines. So because your software can only do one thing at one time, you can pretty much forget about driving a quad 7 segment display. You'll have to get an external driver chip to drive these segments for you. Then you'll have to implement this logic, which should be doable but would be a pain. But remember how I said on our single FPGA we could copy this design several times? Well, there's no way you could do that with a single microcontroller. You'd have a difficult enough time doing this one instance, it'd be impossible to implement a second. But being on the topic of bitbanging, that brings us to my second situation where FPGAs can trump microcontrollers. And that is when you're supporting special hardware. The VGA is special because it's not supported by microcontrollers. But with FPGAs, we can just create the hardware driver ourselves. But let's look at another example. If you saw my Bluetooth N64 controller prototype, you'd see that I use an FPGA to talk to the N64 console. Well, that was accomplished through this design I created. The N64 console uses a proprietary asynchronous half-duplex protocol that isn't supported by microcontrollers. But with the FPGA, I was able to create the hardware drivers myself, right here. I was also able to integrate my own open collector output and input hardware here to implement the bidirectional nature of the protocol. And in parallel to all that, I have a UART module running here. Now, since I only took up a tenth of the space on the FPGA with this design, I can simply copy this entire hardware for the rest of the four controllers. So now that I have those afterthoughts out of the way, let's get back to the oscilloscope. So I got all the physical hardware set up. Here's the FPGA chip that's on a breakout board provided by SparkFun. This yellow wire over here is a shared ground between the Mercury baseboard and the FPGA chip. Then the yellow over here just kind of breaks out the TX pin coming from the FPGA and goes to just the wire, the white and green wire. The green wire goes to the analog to digital converter chip on channel 5, and the white wire goes to DMOD 0, and that's the white wire is the digital read to get this light on the 7 side. Now the FPGA is also powered through USB and connected to my computer right now. And let's take a look at the VGA monitor. Alright, so you can see the VGA output coming from the Mercury baseboard. and I have 10 blue horizontal grid lines that I hard coded, and those are going to denote the start and stop bits and the 8 data bits in between. So I have COM, or I have Plenty open up right here on my computer, and it's opened up on COM 7, which is this FTDI chip. And so on my keyboard, I'm just going to type in the spacebar, and you can see, might be a little difficult to see, but you can see 20 appeared on the 7 segment display, which 20 is the ASCII, which is the ASCII character code for the spacebar. And you can see 20 appears here, the most significant bit starts here, and then it goes to the least significant bit here. As I said before, this is the start bit, and stop it. And you can see I have about 100 pixel cushion on either side, and so the waveform fits really nice and perfectly within the VGA monitor, at least horizontally. So like I said, at 320, it goes 00102000, so 20. 0, if I actually push the key 0, I get 3, which appeared on the 7 tags, and then you get 0011, which is 3, and then 0 is for 0. And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And even if I type in a bunch of random characters on the keyboard, we'll still be able to, at least it perceives to keep up. I hope you enjoyed the video. I hope the application that I showed here is a good demonstration of how powerful FPGAs can be. And thank you for watching the entire video. If you liked the video, if you learned anything, please give me a thumbs up. I really appreciate any feedback. And take care. Today I'll be going over the RN42 Serial Port Protocol Bluetooth module and how to connect a pair of them together. This method will only require the serial communication, so even though I have the RN42 evaluation kit, this will apply to whatever RN42 application you have as well. I'm going to plug in the two RN42 modules into my laptop, and you can see the two RN42 modules are blinking, and here are where my two RN42 modules are, at COM 5 and COM 6. So I just need that information when starting up Plenty. So I'm going to open up one, and it's at 1500, 200, baud. And this is one of them. So if I type in three consecutive dollar signs, I enter this command mode. And by using the plus, I can echo whatever it is I type, otherwise you won't get that feedback, and it's okay, nice. And sometimes these can be a little finicky, just if a command that you enter doesn't work right away, you can just hit enter a few times, and usually that kind of works for me. So I got one, and then I'm going to start the other one. By hitting D, you can get kind of normal general settings to pop up. Here I named one of them RN42-2 for the second module, and this one's RN42-1. What I'm going to do is I'm going to make my RN42-1 the master device, and this one's going to be the slave. So I'm just going to get going on the procedure to get this master to connect to the slave. Now the first step is that if you notice, the module that I intend to be a master is now currently a slave device. So what I need to do is I need to use the SM command to set that to a master device. So now you can see it's a master. Now the next thing you want to do is that this value right here holds the value to the Bluetooth address of your remote module. So here, I want to set this to be equal to the Bluetooth MAC address of this slave device. So you do that with the SR command, and 0006666AC54C. And then if you hit D again, you can see that the remote address is now populated. Now, use the FA command, because here, the authentication is 0, or is 1, I mean. And when it's 1, the device is going to request that a PIN code is entered when another device attempts to connect to it. And since you don't have a method to enter in the PIN code with one RN42 device, you need to set this value to 0, so that way it won't request for the PIN.